Is today your first time here, or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible, because it's the divinely inspired word of God, and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate, and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
All right, just like he said, welcome to church. Welcome to the house of the Lord. We're just so glad that you're here with us. If you're in person or online, find your place of worship. We are going to praise the name of Jesus.
Faithful you are. promises are yes and amen.
All right. Amen. Can we not just say thank you, Jesus, that all his promises are yes and amen. He has not promised to leave us or forsake us. He's promised to give us a hope and a future and to return and to take us home with him one day. So we are just so thankful that you're here. Welcome to Open Door Church. We love you. So nice to see your smiling faces. And if you're online, we just want to see those thumbs up and hearts, because we heart and thumb up you as well. We're just so glad that you're with us. Lots of ways that you can connect, but a super easy one is to text 757-320-5615. This is for new members and for all of us who have been here for many, many years. A great way to connect and to get those text messages in the morning and before events to remind you what's going on here in the house. Do we have any guests with us for the very first time this morning? We just want to welcome you. Wave at us. We do have our visitor packets that we would love to pass to you. So if you're the first time here, we just want to make sure that you get one of our packets, that you can fill that out, and that you can bring it to the front door when you leave. Sister Becky will be there for you this morning, and that you can just hand that to her, or also just leave it with us for the in the offering bucket. So we just love to give. We love to give to one another. We love to give back to the Lord, and because he gives us so much. Is that true? Amen? So lots of different ways you can give. Again, you can text. That easiest way is 757-320-5555. You can also go to odcsuffolk.com/give. You can use your bill pay, and you can do it the old-fashioned way. We can mail in a check or bring it by the office. We also have our offering buckets. Those are in the three back tables. They're gold for you to be able to easily recognize, and you can drop that off. We are a church of giving. We are a church of the world. We reach to the world, and that's how we can do that, is through your tithes and offerings. So not only do we have bills to pay here with the lights and all those things, but we also need to give to others and reach out. So we appreciate all your generosity. And another great way to give is through the Crisis Pregnancy Center. So if you are a donor to that organization, just bless you. Thank you for that. And on June 4th, they're going to do the Walk for Life. This year, it is downtown Norfolk, and it is at the Scope Arena. And Sister Teresa is sponsoring and supporting this organization and representing Open Door Church. So Sister Teresa, if you'll just wave at us, so that you can see her. She has her table out in the foyer at the Welcome Center so that you can sign up to either support her or perhaps go to the event and collect your own sponsors for that. We do have new members class, so that's super exciting. The only way to grow in the house is to bring in the new members and the little ones that grow up to become adults. So we're just so thankful for new members. We have our Growth Track class that will be next month. It's on a Saturday. The dates and times will be announced, but if you are new or have not taken that class, it's a super important class to take so that you can plug into the different ministries here and make sure that we're all on the same page, that we're all under the heading of our pastors, and that we are all teaching and believing the same thing when we teach those little ones in the classroom. And speaking of those little guys, again, we would not be a house full if we didn't have a house full of those little ones. So we do have our nurseries and toddlers. We're going to go to my left, 0 to 3 years old, and then the big kids, 4 to 12, are going to go right outside the foyer, and their teachers are going to take them upstairs. We just love you. We're so glad you're here, and we just want you to stand and find your place of worship again as our worship team leads us, and just lose yourself in the love of Jesus.
Sound coming on the wind.
Worthy, Lord, you're worthy of praise. God, you're worthy of praise. Every circumstance, God, every season, you're still who you are, God. So things around us, God, those things may change, but you never do. So thank you for your faithfulness, God. You're worthy of praise. Amen. We're going to bless his name.
10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name.
Oh, Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in Your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, of the goodness. Let's sing that again.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. Oh, my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God.
Understand what that means. That means we believe that God's goodness is chasing us down, that he desires good things for us, and his will is good toward us, and that he wants us to know that we are a blessed people, that we are his, and that he's chasing us with the good blessings. He's chasing us. We don't have to seek them out and hope and stay in despair. God is chasing us with his goodness. Your goodness is running after me. Your goodness is running after me. When my life laid down and surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am taking, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life, all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am made, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you, God, for your favor, your kindness. Thank you, Lord, that we're always on your mind. Thank you, God, that your eye is always on us. God, we don't have to do things to get your attention because you see us, Lord. You hear us. You know our heart. You know what we need. You know what we need before sometimes we even realize what we need, God. So thank you for having our best interest at heart. Thank you for helping us through hard seasons and being faithful through those moments, God, that life brings. But thank you, God, also for every good blessing. Every good blessing. And God, if anyone in here is struggling with remembering something good today, I pray, God, that you bless them, that you open their eyes, and you help them latch on and see the goodness of God. We love you, God. We ask your blessing upon this time. We're going to receive the word. Let it go deep down in our hearts. And let it minister to us all week long, God. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Hallelujah. Amen. Also, the children may be dismissed at this time in nurseries. Good to see everyone today. Good morning, church. Good morning, church. That's better. That's better. It's good to be here with you guys. It's been brisk the last couple days, huh? Picked a good day yesterday to work outside. That was great. But I recovered. I'm here. So we made it. I didn't, there's no heat stroke or anything like that. I'll let the dust settle a little bit here with the kids and all that before we get going. But God is indeed good. And he indeed runs after us, particularly when we weren't running after him. He was still the faithful one that would come to us, who extended his hand towards us when we weren't even looking. But even though we were in desperate need and we didn't know our level of desperation, he still extended his hand of love toward us. And we should be thankful, because we were dead in our trespasses and sins, and he still, the merciful one, extended his hand toward us. We need just receive. We need to take hold of that hand and quit running. He's running after us, but if we stop running, we will meet him. So he is indeed running after us, but are we running from him? Amen. Well, it seems to have quieted down a little bit. And before I really get into the message, which that wasn't even part of it, but I would like, because, you know, the pastors, Pastor Tony, his mom has been just battling some health issues, and, you know, they've been traveling down to Carolina, which is, what, like 3 hours away, maybe 2 hours, far enough, but still going back and forth, and it's been a little stressful, and it can be a strain on anybody, but I do know that the pastors still, they're still concerned about us. They're our shepherds, so when we're going through stuff, they're bearing our burdens as well. But at this time, I would like us to stand, because I would just like to pray for Pastors Tony and Kathy during this time, just for strength and to just uphold him during this time where it can be stressful and strained. They're still worried about all of us and just dealing with everything down there. So if you would, let's just pray. Father, I do thank you for our pastors. Lord God, just the faithful servants, their dear friends, fellow brothers and sisters, fellow co-heirs with us and Christ in the kingdom, Lord. And we know they're just dealing with some difficulties of life, things that bring strain and pressure, Lord God. And I pray that the peace that surpasses all understanding would just surround them and be through them, Lord God, and just give them the strength, Lord God, as they still bear the burdens for the rest of the congregation, Lord God, and they're still praying for all of us, Lord. So when they're in need, I'm thankful that we would pray for them and uphold them and be a support for them. So, Lord, just pour your blessing upon them and just give them the strength and the grace, Lord God, to keep going, Lord, and to just have peace of mind, peace of heart, peace within their spirit, Lord God. Keep them whole and keep them strengthened. as they continue on, Lord. And we just thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, brothers and sisters, I'm glad to be sharing the word with you today. I don't know how long it's been since the last time. I could have looked that up, but I didn't. All right, so it hasn't been that long, but I'm here today. So I'm glad to be with you, fellow brothers and sisters. We're together in the living room, you know, the family here together. And I believe the Lord's got some thoughts to share with us this morning. And this isn't just an academic exercise. These are thoughts in the scriptures that the Holy Spirit gives to us for our transformation. And like I tell the small group, when we study the word, we study it not just for information, but for what? Transformation, right. And that's what we're doing here. I believe the Lord has a message for us, all of us. And, you know, some parts may seem to apply, other parts may not. But it's still a word that's in season. And it will still apply. And if it's not today, it might be something that applies tomorrow. And it may not be for us, it may be for someone else. So the word is always in season. And God's word never returns void. It will always accomplish what he desires. And so that's what we're getting ready to get into. And we're going to start in Matthew 8. Let me read just four short verses. I don't have a ton of scriptures today, but a lot of information nonetheless. Matthew 8, 1 through 4. When he had come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him, as they often did. And behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Then Jesus put out his hand and touched him, saying, I am willing, be cleansed. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, see that you tell no one, but go away, show yourself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. You know, there are a few different things that I want to address from these four short verses. I'm not sure how much everyone knows about leprosy. Kind of a gnarly disease, if you will. I guess that's a nice way of putting it. Highly infectious skin disease. That was prevalent, at least somewhat, in the Near East during that time, during that culture. It definitely affected Israel, or God wouldn't have put some laws concerning leprosy in there. But not pleasant. I'll call out, you know, my daughter Lindsay, who works in a hospital. I don't know if you've ever encountered anything akin to leprosy, but probably not good. But we do know there would be some open flesh involved. From what I understand, there's also, it affects the nerves. And believe it or not, leprosy still exists today. But from what I understand, that it's commonly known as Hansen's disease now. I just learned that. So, in case you didn't know, I didn't already know that. But Hansen's disease. And there doesn't appear to be a lot of cases annually. So it seems to be somewhat under control. But back then, it would have had some brutal effects. In the Old Testament, some of the laws, and this is in Leviticus 13, we're not going to read it, but the big thing was isolation. You had to be quarantined if you had leprosy. Not only that, if you came across anyone, you had to announce yourself as being unclean before they even got there. All right? Basically, unclean, I have leprosy, stay away. Although people could probably see it, I don't know. I don't know how much of the skin was exposed during that time. But you had to isolate and quarantine yourself. Sound familiar? Very much so. Although I think this would have probably been a little more difficult because there really, honestly, was no treatment back then. You had to ride it out and see if it would heal. And there's some other specifics in the scriptures if you ever read on the laws concerning leprosy. Don't know if you have, but there are some specifics with dealing with the patient or the person and having to go to the priest and what they had to look for to see if it was good or not. But a bad disease. Highly infectious. And so not only was it that you had to quarantine yourself, so you're basically fending for yourself, but socially, you're basically rejected. Like, no, if you had leprosy, no one wanted anything to do with you. So we thought some of the COVID measures maybe were bad, people just kind of maintaining 6 feet. Well, I can guarantee you people were probably maintaining a lot more than 6 feet when someone with leprosy was coming down the road. They were staying clear away. And you know what? Rightfully so. I don't want to be unfair because it was highly infectious. So if to come into contact with people, it was communicable, it would keep spreading, and a lot more people would be infected. So the Lord put these prohibitions into place, or the laws concerning they have to isolate. And there was really no other choice because there was no other remedy. So to keep everyone from getting it, they had to isolate. So the Lord in his wisdom, he knew about quarantine way before any of our current day medical professionals, right? And the Lord had other laws concerning that in the Old Testament, dealing with hygiene, how to deal with like mold remediation in their homes way back then. He was, the Lord's way ahead of his time, way ahead of our time, I should say. So he knew how to handle things, and he knew a lot of the other surrounding nations of Israel weren't doing these things. And it was probably just running rampant. But the Lord was showing them a better way, and a better way to live, a better way to conduct themselves, and in just physically, you know, let alone the sin aspects. But the Lord knew what he was doing. So anyway, it would have been hard on someone with leprosy, needless to say. All right, they would have been isolated, socially rejected, you know, even from their own family members. It would have been tough. Not an easy thing to deal with. So this man was desperate. Obviously, anybody with a disease of any kind, and certainly with leprosy, and more specifically this man, would have been desperate to be healed. So we saw, as I already read, that Jesus, or he approached Jesus. And what did Jesus do, this man with a highly infectious disease? He touched him. Touched him. He put his hands on the man with the disease that everyone else was trying to avoid. No one would even come close to this man, but Jesus puts his hand on him. But then again, Jesus wasn't like anyone else, and is not like anyone else. True? Amen. The man said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Willing. He was willing. So I started thinking about this word. And of course, I went to the dictionary, just in the English, to see what this willing mean. And what I found was of or relating to the will, the power of choosing, the volition, the power of choice that is within our control, related to our will. Our wills being the thing that we want. What is that thing that we desire? That is our will. So in essence, this man was saying, "Lord, if you want to, Lord, if you choose to, Lord, if it is your desire, you can heal me." And of course, Jesus healed the man. Hallelujah. Amen. And we know that the Lord still heals today, does he not? And I don't care what it is. I don't care how sick or broken or lost or dirty or wayward or how many failures you've encountered in this life. When others go the other way and avoid you, or don't know what to do for you, or have written you off, it's that time that the Lord extends his hand towards us and he touches us. Amen. Sir or madam, if that is you, and if you've got breath in your lungs, there is still hope for you. And the Lord will touch you if you keep running from him. And he will heal you. You don't have to have leprosy. Your mind could be under attack. You could be emotionally distraught. Your spirit could be in the gutter. It could be any number of things. But the Lord heals the whole person, every part of us. And he makes us whole. That is what the Lord does for us. Amen? Amen. What else did this man do? What did he do before he even asked for the healing? Let's spot. Can we put the verses back up? Lainey, O daughter. Were they up there the first time? Oh, okay. I didn't even look behind me. What did he do before he even asked if he was willing? This is a test. What? He worshiped him. Before he even asked Jesus to heal him, before he even asked if he was willing, he worshiped him. This man knew that Jesus was the Son of God. He recognized. He saw the power that was within him. He knew that he could do it. Brothers and sisters, this is such a key component of our walk with the Lord. And I don't say this in a bad way, but, you know, we really should. The Lord wants us to ask for things. He wants us to come to him. But at the same time, there's an element where we don't want to treat the Lord like an ATM. And before we come with our petitions, we should extend worship unto him. Now, if someone's never walked with the Lord, they're just coming to him for the first time, they don't know any different, The Lord hears. The Lord always hears. But maybe some of us have been walking with the Lord for a while, or maybe even we're new. But you know, our requests should always come with worship, because we have to recognize God for who he is, the creator, the sustainer, the redeemer of this world and us. And he wants us to come to him with our petitions, with our cares, with our concerns. But it must, should accompany worship. And what is worship? We're telling God that he is worthy. We're giving to him what he is due. He is worth it. He is worth our admiration, worth our praise. You know, we praise all kinds of different things in this world. We give a lot of honor and due and worship and praise to a lot of things in this world. There is a place for some honor and respect, but not our worship. There's only one that is worthy of our worship, Jesus Christ. Because he is the only one that extends his hands out and touches the sick and the lost and the wayward and the dirty, the ones with the infectious skin disease, physically and inside. Maybe an internal leprosy of sorts. Our spirits could be leprous, but he reaches out and he touches, because that's the kind of God that he is. He loves us, but we should extend our worship to him, just like this man did. He worshiped him first, and then he said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me. Thanks be to the Lord, he did, and he does it for us. And so, part of our jobs, our mission, is to worship the Lord with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. This isn't a heartless ritual or routine. We're giving praise, we're giving honor and worship to the Most High God. And we give worship in all circumstances, leprosy or not, because he's worthy. Notice this man didn't question the ability of Jesus. He didn't ask if he could heal. He already knew that he could heal. He believed. He had faith. He knew the power was within Jesus to do that work. And he humbly asked if Jesus was simply willing to do what he was already capable of doing. Lord, if you are willing. Lord, if you want to. Lord, if you choose to. Lord, if you desire to, you can make me whole. Jesus, in his mercy, healed the man. So it appears there's this line between ability or capability and willingness. There may be things in our own lives, in our own stories, that maybe we were willing to do, but simply lack the ability. Perhaps perform a concerto. I might be willing, but I do not have the ability. Defuse a bomb. You certainly want the person that has the capabilities to do that, whether it's training or natural ability. You don't want someone just winging it. Red wire or blue? I'm not sure. I might be willing all day. You know, you need someone to defuse that, I'm your guy, right? But I don't have the abilities. Again, whether it's natural ability or through training, it's still a capability. Brain surgery. I'm not your guy. So I might be willing to attempt many things, but I lack the capability. Conversely, there may be things that are within our capabilities, but we lack the willingness. Like eating liverwurst. Within my capabilities to do that, I have no willingness to eat liverwurst. In fact, I don't let my wife eat it either. Not while I'm around. If you don't know what it is, just be thankful. It's nasty. Thank you, Michelle. Yeah, amen. Pastor Tony doesn't let Pastor Kathy eat sauerkraut. But you will always get the amen from me for sauerkraut. So. But not liverwurst. Riding a roller coaster. That would be within my ability, but I have no willingness to ride a roller coaster. You may not have known that about me, but I will do a lot of things, but I do not want to get on one of those. I've been on them and still hate them. And my wife tries to coax me to get me on there as if I'm suddenly going to change. It's like trying to reason like with a crazy person. Like, it doesn't matter. I hate them. You're not going to change my mind. I'm almost 50 years old. I'm not just going to start magically liking roller coasters. Not going to happen. I have the ability to change a poopy diaper. Don't want to do it. Nope. And just so you know, I have 7 children. I changed all their diapers. So I'm not the guy that never touched a diaper. I did it plenty. I'm retired. And I have many grandchildren already, but I don't know. It would have to be dire straits. And of course, I'll chip in if I really have to. Those are some things that I have the ability. You could come up with your own list, but lack willingness. I think most people would agree that we have a free will. I haven't heard too many people nowadays that would argue that we have a free will. Now, remember, what did I talk about the will as being? It's what we want. That is our will. It's what we desire. The thing that we want to happen. Maybe the thing we want to pursue. But it's also the power to make choices. That is our will. And it's free. We are free to make choices. That's how God designed us, and I'm thankful for that. Because we're not puppets on a string. We're not robots. He created mankind to be in a free, loving relationship with Him. Not people that He would just control. So we can, in a sense, choose what we want. We can choose to pursue that which we desire. The pursuit of happiness, I guess we could say that, right? It's in one of our founding documents. Which one? Pursuit of happiness. It's in what? Founding document for this country? Declaration of Independence? All right. Start researching because the 4th of July is coming up, so let's get that on the forefronts, people. But in another sense, there are many things that were not our will. Of course, our DNA and our corresponding physical traits, we had no choice in that. That wasn't our will, although people seem to alter some of those things these days. We didn't choose our parents or the family we were born into or where we were born or how we were raised. We didn't choose those things. Those were not within our will. You could probably think of some other things. Life circumstances, many of the things that just happened to us, we didn't choose those things. Those were not within our will. But more importantly was we didn't choose to be born into the sinful nature. That was not within our will. From the time of Adam, with the original sin, it was passed down to every single one of us. And I'm not going to go into the details about the an age of accountability and how it's used against us. The fact is that we were all born into the sinful nature. That wasn't part of our free will. So in a sense, we were kind of born into bondage, even though we have the power of choice within that. This is important. We cannot simply choose our way out of the sin nature. Our free will has no effect upon that in and of itself. You see, there's abilities that God has, and there's abilities that we have. There's a willingness that God has, and there's a willingness that we have. And in case you don't know, they're not the same, necessarily. Maybe some things. But there's a lot of things where willingness and ability is much different between God and us. There was a willingness for God the Father to send His one and only Son into the world. As we'll look at those scriptures in John, of course, the famous John 3:16. But we're going to add John 3:17 to that as well. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Amen to that. There was something God not only had the willingness to do, but he had the ability to do. And thank God he did, or we would be hopeless. That's what I'm talking about. Regardless of what we may, our good intentions, when it comes as a sinful nature, we can have the power to choose a lot of things, but we can't choose ourselves out of the sinful nature and into the kingdom of God. What we just read is the only way that that happens. And it's because God not only had the ability to do it, but he had the willingness to send his Son to the earth and all the work that he performed. And when he rose, or when he was crucified, buried, and rose again and ascended, because of all those things that happened, we have hope. But it's because he had the ability and the willingness to do it. He did not leave us alone. He did not leave us just to our own devices. So we have a free will, but it wouldn't have gotten us out of the predicament. Jesus died for the ungodly to pay a ransom. He purchased us with his very own blood. 1 Peter 1:18-20. For you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was paid not paid with mere silver or gold, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. God chose him as your ransom long before the world began. But now in these last days, he has been revealed for your sake. So that, again, to purchase with blood, to be a ransom, was the thing that only he had the ability to do. And certainly he was willing to do it for you and me. Like I said, he defeated death and rose from the grave. He ascended to the right hand of the Father, where he makes intercession for us. Things that only he has the ability to do. And we thank him for his willingness. So what about us in all of this? What are some things that are within our ability to do? What are the things that we are willing to do? What lengths are people willing to go to in order to achieve or experience some kind of goal in the natural? That's a question. What lengths are you willing to go to? That's like a common question. So it indicates what's the level of sacrifice that you're going to put forth in order to achieve a goal. What lengths are you, am I, willing to go to achieve something I want to see happen or do? Maybe just for freedom, and not even spiritual. I'm just talking about like someone's in bondage in the natural. For freedom, what lengths are people willing to go to be free? What lengths are people willing to go to sometimes for money? Quite a bit, from what we could tell. Or for success, or some level of security in their life, happiness, education, dreams, relationships, power. You could probably think of some other things. What lengths are people willing to go to? What level of sacrifice will sometimes people endure in order to achieve some of these things in this life, here on the earth? People are willing sometimes to do quite a bit. Some people are willing to give up almost everything to achieve something they want to achieve. Sometimes leaving a wake of destruction behind them. I mean, not all these things are bad. I'm not speaking out against education or having dreams or, you know. But the point is that sometimes people are willing to do quite a lot in order to achieve those things. People have the choice to pursue any number of goals or ideals. There has to be a willingness to pursue anything. Not just going to happen, right? We know this. Oftentimes, we just need the ability. But when it comes to our walk with God, when it comes to our spiritual transformation, when it comes to our own healing and restoration, when it comes to our own maturity and growth in the kingdom, when it comes to being more like Jesus, to be more like Christ, the one who paid a ransom for us, what lengths are we willing to go to, if any? You see, there is an easy yoke and there is a light burden that Jesus talked about, where we don't have to hustle or grind or make it happen. It's an offer there for us. It's the offer that only He has the ability to make and the willingness. Here's a question. It's a little wordy, but I think it's a good one. Are we willing to do the things we have the ability to do so that Jesus can do the things that only He has the ability and willingness to do? I'll say that again. Are we willing to do the things that we have the ability to do so that Jesus can do the things that only He has the ability and willingness to do? Look, we should all want to grow and mature in our walk with the Lord. Let's be honest. We're just not here we're not checking a box here. Shouldn't be. We're not here out of routine or ritual. We're not here to just appease the Lord by showing up. The Christian life is a lot more than that. We come to Him because we know that we're lost and broken. And if you haven't done this, if you're in this room, you've never come to Christ, you are lost and broken. Maybe you haven't felt the full weight of that yet, but you need a Savior. And Jesus, everything He went through, we read that, John 3:16-17, He is here. He's running after you, as the song goes. And He's extending His hand out, and He's wanting to touch you in your life to make you whole. And if you've never done that, you have the ability to do so. Be the best decision you ever made in your life, and you'll never be the same. You'll be a new creation. Amen. But for those of us that have already done that, we should be wanting to grow and mature, to be more and more like Christ. That's kind of the point. He's growing us and maturing us so that we can have an impact here in this life for His kingdom, touching other people, helping them to grow, bringing others into the kingdom. And all this is a culmination, so for one day when there will be a new heavens and a new earth, and we will reside with Him in His kingdom, physically present with the Lord. That's what all this is growing to. That's why we're growing and maturing, because it all carries over into the next life. It doesn't just stop. Death isn't the end, physical death. Everything that we're doing now, the things that we're willing to do, the sacrifices we make for Him and His kingdom, as we grow and we grow closer to Him, it all ushers into the next life. It doesn't just reset with like an easy button, we hit it, and it all starts over. No, all of this counts. All of this matters that we're doing now. This carries into eternity. That's why we say it so often. That's why it's important that we grow and mature now. That's why we challenge. So if there's challenging words today, good. That's for our own benefit, and I say them to me too. But of course, that doesn't mean that the problems and challenges of life disappear. It means that we face those problems with more confidence and reliance upon Him because of the depth of our relationship we have with Him. We learn not to rely upon our own strength. And we do have strength. He gives us strength. But when we face difficulties and challenges and problems, we don't just rely upon our own strength. We call upon His strength first. And He enables us to do what we need to do. So also at the same time, we don't sit around and do nothing. We go to Him so He can enable us to do what needs to be done. And eventually, as we mature, we become a source of strength to others. We become a source for other people. That's what this community is about. That's what this family of God is about. That's what this kingdom is about. That's how we increase in strength to come, the kingdom. And God uses us to do that. He uses people. It's the power of the Holy Spirit in us, working and helping others and touching others. No doubt you've heard the expression, ready, willing, and able. Right? Everyone's heard that? Yep, kind of the same thing. But the things I'm talking about now are the things we are able to do. It's not just about what we are able to do, it's more about our willingness. just a few questions, just general questions I threw together about willingness. Are we willing to be plugged into a community with other believers where we can share our lives? In a sense, we're doing this here, but of course, I would also encourage everyone to be part of a small group where that continues to happen and more of that happens than just Sunday morning. Are we willing to confess our sins to God and other believers as appropriate, trusted believers, as the scriptures tell us to do? Are we willing to ask questions when we don't understand something about prayer or worship or reading scripture without fear of embarrassment? That's a big hang-up for people. There's things that people don't understand and they just don't ask because they're embarrassed. There should be no embarrassment. There's no shame in asking a question. If you don't understand something that's being taught, or when we talk about something we do in service, or people raising their hands, or people speaking in tongues, ask the question. Ask another believer. Right? If anyone, and, you know, I mean, I'm not Pastor Tony, but if someone seeks to embarrass someone else for asking a question, I know I want to know about it. And I know Pastor Tony would want to know about it. Because that just means something hasn't been handled the proper way. But you know, there has to be a willingness there to ask questions if something's not, if we don't have a level of understanding. Does that make sense to you guys? Okay, good. Are you willing to be vulnerable? Come on now. If we're going to be in a shared life with other people, there's going to be some level of vulnerability. If you're going to have friends, which is another question, are you willing to have a friend? Or be a friend, there's going to be some exchange, some level of vulnerability. Because if we're going to be any point where we confess one to another, or tell people what we're struggling with, or tell people we're doubting when things are hard, there's a vulnerability there. But are we willing to be vulnerable and put away the facade? You may not believe this, but I'm a guy who's had a facade. Some of you that know me probably find that funny. Are we willing to be intimate with God? To learn how to talk to Him? To learn how to worship Him? These are things that need to be learned. It's not, I just had a salvation experience and poof. All of a sudden I know how to read the scriptures and pray and worship and just know all that stuff. These are things that need to be taught over time. But are we willing to enter into the process? And willing to ask the questions and willing to be taught? Are we teachable? These are all things for our growth, brothers and sisters. Are we willing to let the Lord work on us and in us? You know, sometimes the Lord talks about growth. I'm no gardener or an arborist or horticulturist. But I do know, at least to a level, at least I guess with trees and stuff, if you want them to grow more or have more growth or flower more, what do you typically have to do to them? You have to prune them. I did hear that. Now, I don't do that to any of my trees, but I do know people do it. See it with the crepe myrtles quite a bit. But I do know that's a thing. And believe you me, the Lord, if we're willing, the Lord will prune us. There will be areas where He's cutting things off of our life. There will be things where He's requiring us to change. There may be activities that get cut off or relationships that get cut off. He's going to challenge us in that. Are we willing to allow Him to do that in us and for us? And sometimes people are not. When those things come by, sometimes people say, I've had enough. I'm out. But we don't want that. We shouldn't want that. We want the Lord to keep working on us. You know why? Because He knows what's best. He knows what's best for our growth. He knows what's best for our health. And so we should allow Him. We should be willing to allow the Lord to prune us, because only He can do that. Now, life has a way of beating us up as it is, right? But that's not necessarily for our spiritual growth. It may make us a little stronger, a little tougher, but it doesn't necessarily mean we're going to mature, certainly not in the kingdom. The Lord has a way of using life circumstances to prune us and to shape us and to cause us to grow and increase in health, but we have to be willing. Are you willing to let God in? To stop running, as the song. He's running after us. Are we willing to stop running? Are we willing to stop fighting him? Or like holding a toddler on your lap, what do they often do? Don't say sleep. That's not what I'm getting at. Squirm? Did I hear a squirm? Are we willing to stop squirming? Think about that. There's times the Lord just wants to hold us there and be with him. But oftentimes we squirm. Because maybe it's uncomfortable. Maybe we feel guilty about something. We have to stop squirming. Are we willing? Are we willing to let him touch our lives like Jesus and administer grace, strength, and power unto us so that we can be effective for his kingdom? You see, this isn't just a list of things to go out and do. This isn't like a war cry, go out, read your Bible more, pray more. A lot of these things, there is plenty of proactive things to do in the kingdom. A lot of these things are receiving. Are we willing to let the Lord do what only he can do in us? We have to be intentional about that. It just doesn't happen. We have to take a look at our lives and what our normal routines and practices. Are we willing to allow the Lord to do these things in us and for us? We have to be intentional about it. Because we don't have the ability to save ourselves. We don't have the ability to give ourselves more grace. We don't have the ability to make the Holy Spirit inhabit us and have power and use our gifts to the full. Remember, we're talking about willingness. Jesus had an ability to do something, and he was willing, and he did it. We have the ability to do certain things. We just need the willingness. We don't have the ability to heal ourselves, whether body, mind, emotions, or spirit. We don't have the ability to mature ourselves and transform ourselves into the image of Christ. These are the things that only he has the ability. He is willing. Are we? What are the things that we are willing to do to be closer to him, to be more like him? Will you stand with me? As we see from just these few brief scriptures, the Lord has set a challenge before us. And that's not something we have to go run out and storm the gates of hell, right, and try to take over and forcefully make the kingdom happen. These aren't things that we have to, flagellate ourselves, right, and have a steel discipline that we have to go out and we have to do more. I have to do more. This isn't about doing. This is about willingness and allowing the Lord to do what only he can do, because he is willing. He's willing. The Holy Spirit is willing to reach down and perform that work in us that only he can do. We can't fix ourselves. We can't change ourselves. Whether you've never received the Lord before, you can't save yourself. Whether we're already in the kingdom and we're still trying to grow and mature and we're struggling, you can't do that for yourself. We still have to allow him to work in us. It never ends, and we don't want it to end. We want him to continue to prune us and shape us and work in us, but we have to have a willingness to let him and not resist and to stop squirming. We may think we don't squirm, but you need to take a good look. We squirm. We will squirm because it's going to be unpleasant at times. But that's the Lord. That's the Holy Spirit working on us. Wanted to take us further and deeper and closer to him. We just have to not squirm and not resist. So let's pray. Now we'll ask this, if there's any in here, you've never given your heart to Jesus. Let me tell you, you can't save yourself. You have an ability to choose, but you can't choose yourself into salvation. There's a work that only Jesus could do, that he did, that he effected from the work here he did on the earth through the cross. Right? God sent him for that purpose, to die, to be buried, to defeat death, to rise again, and to ascend to the Father. And that same power that rose Jesus from the dead is in every believer. So you can call upon the name of Jesus and he will save you. Just like the man that called out for healing. He said, Lord, if you are willing. If you never called upon Jesus, you can ask that question. Lord, if you are willing, you can save me. Jesus says, I am willing. So if there's nobody that has ever done that, as we pray, you can call upon the Lord and he will touch you and he will change you and you will be a new creation. You know what, I just ask that if you did that today, that you tell somebody as we're praying. Tell me, tell someone else maybe you came with, if you're a visitor, let somebody else know so that we can help you continue on in your journey of faith. But for everyone else, and the Lord is here, he's present, the Holy Spirit is here, he's challenging us and questioning us and asking, son or daughter, are you willing? Are you willing to get rid of those distractions and the things that happen that prevent me from helping you go further, from deeper, from restoration? Because Jesus can heal the mind. Jesus can heal the emotions. He has the ability. Jesus can heal the body, and he's willing. Are we willing to let him perform his work in our lives? It doesn't matter how long we've been walking with the Lord. There's a level that we can go deeper. There's a greater level of maturity. There's more. We can become more and more like him all the way to the end. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, are we willing? Are we willing? Lord, I pray for all of us that are here today, that are present, the part of the family that couldn't make it today, anyone maybe listening online. Lord, I pray, I thank you that you extend your hand of mercy towards us. Lord, I pray for all of us, Lord, to relent in those areas where we're not allowing you to come in. Give us the willingness, Lord God. We're calling upon your name, Lord, that we may grow deeper and deeper, Lord God, and become more and more like you, Lord. So eventually we exhibit those traits, Lord, where we don't have to try to be something, we just are. Because you in us, your power in us, Lord. Lord, challenge us. I ask you to challenge us, Lord, and show us those areas where we need to be more willing to let you in. Father, I thank you for the work that you perform, that you are the willing God who never gives up, no matter where we've come from, no matter what we've been through, no matter how dirty or how much people avoid us or how many times we failed, you are the willing Lord who comes in, heals us and sets us right and places us back on the path. So I thank you for that, Lord God. I pray for power, Holy Spirit power, for each and every one that's here today. Lord, a level of strength and ability, Lord God, unlike ever before. I pray blessing over everyone in this congregation, unlike ever before, that they've experienced or encountered, Lord. And I pray they have a willingness to receive it. So we thank you for today, Lord. We thank you that you are the Holy One. You are the Righteous One. Lord, you are the creator, the redeemer, the sustainer of this world, of this universe. Lord, and we give you all the glory because you alone are worthy. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, everybody. God bless you. We are dismissed. Hallelujah.